Jeremy Virgil, our defensive team. Deacon Rose, his son, from Tracy Jackson. You know, all those defense front end teams. We've got all the defense. Everybody just needs to work. And I just got to take a moment. If y'all don't mind me taking a moment to shout out. But at the same time, I thank all of you who have been faithful in doing that, which God has called us to do in terms of being diligent in his word, first of all. But call to God take day to make you to be the sponsor of his word during this season. I cannot tell you enough how grateful I am for this year. We've been up for almost 200 days now, which serves the word of God. And some of y'all ain't just today. Some of y'all have just been. But just had on Wednesday, you showed a level of faith in God. So I'm grateful for you. I got to say this while I go any further. I talked to you last week and yesterday, and I had in front of people, you know, that we were talking last week about trying to be a benefit to children and our church may not be able to have all the assistance in the education. Well, I have been praying for it. And I'm not even saying I just asked when the Lord and the deacon in our heart and decided to do it. Then I get a phone call that says, hey, you know, are you good? We're trying to, you know, do some programs in the church. What can we do to help? And I had never even mentioned it to anybody outside the church. The Lord said, do it to resource for us to be able to do this. I got to say it, but God did. Now, our other concern was, hey, we're going to make sure we keep things clean and in the church. And when we get ready to come back, whatever that is, we want to have these together. We want to have these, how do they say, sanctified? We want things sanctified too. We want them, you know, like sterilized. There we go. Sterilized. So we want to be sanctified and sterilized. And I was, you know, just trying to figure out these things, not being sanctified, help us to go out to church and trying to figure out how to do it. Got a phone call today. Somebody said, hey, you know, this is what we're doing. We're doing the doctor's office. You know, church needs. I said, well, if we don't need, we need to get back to church. I was telling this story just to remind us that God bless faith. I remember when I first came to Pastor Reverend Davis, he said that repeatedly. And I can come to see it in the fact that God doesn't bless us because we're fans, because we wear fans clothes. He blessed us being faithful to him.
Being faithful.
Can y'all hear me now? Am I on the phone?
Yeah. Well, I heard you the whole time.
Okay. Well, I'm sorry. I think I have to mute myself on the phone. But phone, if y'all still here, I'm glad.
We can hear you better now. We can hear you better okay. Now, but we weren't hearing you.
Okay. Perfect. Okay. Well, we turned to the book of Zechariah. In the Old Testament. And we're going to continue our operation on walking with the Lord. We're going to continue our journey, our class on walking with the Lord. We have discussed a few things already. We recognize that God gave us the command to walk with him in everything. He gave, in Deuteronomy, God gave the command to the people of Israel to walk with God. And in doing so, they would prosper the land. They would be well with them in the land. And then God said, I give you long life in the land, longevity in the land. That's what God promised to those. In philosophy, we reminded that as we walk in Christ, what we'll find out is in walking in Christ, I want to be clear, that we are able to then experience walking with God, because when we walk with God, we get access to God through Jesus Christ. And that's really how we come to Christ, come to God anyway, through Jesus Christ. So as we walk in Christ, or walk in Christ, we get to walk with God. Tonight in the book of Zechariah, we're going to see another element of walking with God. We're going to see how it looks, why we should do it, and then the benefits of it. In the book of Zechariah, we recognize it's one of the minor prophets. But again, I got to say it every time. It's a minor prophet only in the sense that of the volume of the work, not the importance of the work. Every word that Zechariah said was a holy word that came from God. And every word was relevant then and is relevant to us now as we apply it to our lives. And so saying that, Zechariah was, as along with Haggai, were prophets who prophesied to the the remnant who had been in Babylonian captivity. Now, while we looked at Isaiah and Hosea and Amos and the other prophets, they were prophesying to people who were prospering, but he was telling them the trouble was going to come. Haggai and Zechariah instead were prophesying to people who had experienced the trouble. Many of the readers of the book of Zechariah had, in fact, I want to be clear about this, they had, in fact, been born in Babylonian captivity. They had only heard stories. They didn't even have memories. Many of them only had stories of what they heard from their parents and their grandparents about the beautiful and wonderful relationship that God had with his people, Israel, when they were in the promised land. They heard about the temple. They heard about the walls of Jerusalem. They heard about how God had blessed his people. They heard about how God had brought his people out of the bondage of slavery. They heard how God had delivered them from Balaam. They heard how God had run out the Jebusites, Perizzites, Hittites, and all the other ites out of Israel. They heard about it, but they had been born in Babylonian captivity because of their disobedience to God. That's what they were coming from. And they were coming back to Israel initially to rebuild the walls and then to rebuild the temple. And so Haggai began his ministry preaching to the first remnant. And then Zechariah continued the prophetic ministry of encouragement to those people who were the second wave of people. So I want to get again. First wave, Haggai. Second wave, Zechariah. But the purpose of their prophetic ministry was one of encouragement. The people had been broken. If you can imagine being locked up in a foreign land, and I say locked up, even though they could walk around, they couldn't go back home. They were trapped in a foreign land. They had no way to connect with the God who called them. They were disconnected, and many of them were born disconnected, disappointed, and just disoriented because they were not where God had designed for them to be. And so as they came back to the land, as they came back to Israel, many of these people had already felt defeated. And I'm going to pause parenthetically and say that's what can happen in life. If situations can break you down, situations can make you feel defeated, even when your victory is in your face. One of the things that happens is it's a mindset. If you feel like you're worthless, guess what? You're going to act worthless. If you feel like you're worthless, you're going to feel like people look at you as worthless, and then your behavior will be that of a worthless people. And so what Zechariah's message really was to remind them that they still belong to God. They were God's people, and that God was going to restore them because he had promised it. So if we do this one more time, some of the prophets prophesied, last night we discussed this, prophets prophesied of destruction, but then they also prophesied of God's redemption. Now, these prophets, Haggai and Zechariah particularly, are prophesying about the redemption and giving them the understanding of the necessity. I want to say this, the understanding of the necessity of them trusting God for their full restoration. So now we're talking about redemption and restoration as opposed to talking about punishment, judgment, and later restoration. Now we're dealing with the restoration. So in the third chapter of Zechariah, go ahead and turn to chapter 3, we see this prophetic place, this oracle that God gave Zechariah. If I could just go through the little overview. In chapter 1, it was a call to repentance. They were called to repentance not because of what they had done previously. They were called to repentance because many of them had given out and got tired rebuilding the temple, rebuilding the walls, rather. There was a vision of horses in chapter 1, and then at the end of chapter 1, there was a message that the Lord would comfort Zion. He would comfort his people because they were broken. Remember when they were trying to, we know this in the book of Nehemiah and Ezra, that when they were coming back, the enemies of Israel came back as well. They said, you know what, we ain't going to have Israel get strong again. And so they fought against them. And this is what I want us to understand, that right now we're in a captive place. But when God brings us back, I want to be clear. I want to say this to everybody who's listening. When God brings us back, do not be shocked that there will be attacks by the world on the body of Christ, because they will see that God is doing great things in our midst. I believe this. Now, that, I don't want you to get discouraged by it. I just want you to be aware of it, because that has always been the case. When God is blessing his people and restoring and redeeming his people, guess what? There's always somebody led by the prince of the air, Satan himself, who is trying to break us or discourage us in doing that which God has called us to do. We come out of church, somebody's going to feel like, well, I don't want to do this, I don't want to do that. Understand, that's just the enemy attack. And instead of doing that, listen to the text for the day so that we'll understand how God wants us to walk when our redemption and our restoration comes. I want to say it again. Restoration for the church today is on the way. We're being restored. Even right now, God is prepping us for restoration. But we got to know how to walk in restoration. In chapter 2, God gave Zechariah a vision of the measure line. He talks about the future joy of Zion and other nations who will be blessed. And look at this. the future joy of Zion, God's people, and also the other nations. What does that mean? God used Israel to bless the entire world. God used Israel to be a blessing because other nations got to see God, and other folk in other nations, maybe not the whole nation, but other folk in other nations came to understanding and a relationship with God. Can I tell somebody today, God is blessing and is blessing, has blessed, and will bless the world through his body of believers, known as the body of Christ. And our job then is to understand that first and foremost, and then recognize that the joy, a world, let's just take our country in sorrow, in turmoil. God, if we stand and do what this text says today, God will bless the nation, United States of America, not because of who's president, not because of the Dow Jones Industrial, not because of the economy. God will bless America because of our obedience to him. Who? The body of Christ. Because when somebody's in Christ and you take a stand, guess what? Somebody else sees the Christ in you and wants to serve the Lord as well. For too long, I got to say this, for too long, the church has allowed the world to dictate how we act. Now it's time for the church to dictate how the world should act. That's what we got to do. We got to live for Christ so that the world will see that something about Jesus that we need to know. Even folk who plan church will say, we know what? We really want to be about Jesus so that God can bless us in a special and mighty way. Look at verse chapter 3. I'm just going to jump on chapter 3 now. Now, in chapter 3, sometimes I get so carried away, I'll be halfway through. Okay, I got some time. In chapter 3, Zechariah begins this prophecy. In chapter 3, verse 1, here's what he says. He said, then he showed me Joshua the high priest standing before the angel of the Lord. That's the first picture. The vision came to Zechariah that Joshua, not the Joshua in the Old Testament, but the high priest Joshua, was standing before the angel of the Lord. So it was Joshua and the angel of the Lord that were standing there. But at the same time, if you keep reading, it says, and Satan standing at his right hand to oppose him. So God and the angel, the high priest and the angel were there, but Satan was opposing him. What that means is Satan was trying to prevent him from accomplishing what it is God had given him to do. Now, let me go back and tell you what that means. The high priest had a job in the Old Testament. Most of us know it, but I'm going to say it again. The high priest's job was to represent man before God. That was his job. And his God was to bring back and say, hey, God covered our sins for another year. So to bring the good news message back to people. That was a unique relationship that God had called for the high priest. So the high priest was in position to do his work. And the angel was there representing God and God's power and God's goodness. But watch this. But the angel and Satan was standing at his right hand. Satan was trying to prevent the high priest from doing his work, being a mediator between God and man. Now, that's what we see in verse 1. Verse 2, and it said, the Lord said to Satan, the Lord rebuke you, Satan. So God spoke to Satan, as he always has, like he threw him out of heaven. And God, remember this, God is sovereign, omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent. God is not in any way, shape, form or fashion afraid of Satan. So he spoke to Satan, Satan, I rebuke you. The Lord rebuke you, Satan. And the Lord who has chosen Jerusalem rebuke you. He declared it. And so I want to say this again. So Satan stood rebuked. But this doesn't mean that he quit. That the Lord has chosen Jerusalem, who has chosen Jerusalem, rebuke you. Is this not a brand plucked from the fire? Here's what I want us to understand about Israel. Israel was chosen by God. All of us were chosen by God. Somebody said, I don't remember that, Pastor. Let me go on back and tell you. In the book of Ephesians chapter 1, it says we are chosen. In 1 Peter, said we are the elect, which means we're chosen. Israel was chosen by God, and guess what? We're chosen by God as well. And because we're chosen by God, and we're plucked by God out of certain depth in the flames of hell, God doesn't just pluck us, he keeps us. In the book of John, it lets us know that whoever Jesus has in his hand is covered by God because he's in God's hand, and so we are protected in that reality. But let me just go a little further. I want to paint the picture here. Is this not a brand plucked from the fire? Verse 3 says, now Joshua, look at this, what it says. The high priest was clothed with filthy garments and was standing before the angel. So what Zechariah saw was a high priest who was standing before the angel of the Lord, but he was dirty. He was wearing dirty clothes. He was wearing filthy garments. Now, it wasn't that God was telling Zechariah that the angel was filthy. What God was telling Zechariah is that the high priest was filthy. He was telling the high priest that he was telling Zechariah, rather, that the high priest felt like he was dirty. Let me say it again. It wasn't that God said Zechariah, the high priest, was filthy. He was saying the high priest feels filthy because of their spiritual immaturity, A, and because of the fact that they felt disconnected from God because of what they had gone through to this point. They had been in Babylonian captivity. They had no spiritual foundation like they should have. They had been in Babylonian captivity. They had spiritual insecurity. They knew they belonged to God, but didn't know what that meant. And so the high priest was not fully able to do his work because he felt inadequate. Can I say something right now? So many of us as Christians feel inadequate. We don't feel like we're good enough to be blessed by God. We don't feel like we're capable of being blessed by God. We feel like something we've done or something we didn't do causes us to not be worthy of God's blessing. And we feel filthy when we're not filthy because we are saved, sanctified, and set apart by God through the Holy Spirit. Can I say that one more time? We feel inadequate. And so many Christians don't serve God, don't love, don't fellowship with God, don't have a devotion to God because we don't feel worthy of our relationship with God. And so what God was telling Zechariah is to tell this remnant that they look like this, but I got another plan for them. Look at verse 4. Then he asked and spoke to those who stood before him, saying, take away the filthy garments from him. God told Zechariah to tell them, take them ragged clothes off of him. And it was for Israel. Israel could see it, and we need to see it too. God has taken away our raggedy clothes. How about that? Before we got saved, we were ragged. But in Christ, we're no longer ragged. Why? Because we're justified by faith and declared righteous by God because we talked about this last night. We are in Jesus Christ. Take away the filthy garments from him. And to him, he said, see, I remove your iniquities from you, and I will clothe you with rich clothes. God said, tell Israel that I've removed their iniquity from them. They have paid the penalty. I gotta say it again. They have paid the penalty. Why? They were in Babylonian captivity. God said that's what was going to happen. But he said when that penalty was over, when that process was over, God was going to restore them. Can I tell you something right here? The penalty for our sin has been paid for, not by our captivity, but it's been paid for by the precious blood of Jesus on the cross of Calvary. God is trying to tell us, your iniquity has been paid for. Your iniquity has been dealt with by the precious blood of Jesus. And so you may look at yourself as being ragged and dirty, but God doesn't see us like that because if you have faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior, you're not dirty, but instead you are righteous before God. Now, that's the reality. I want to tell everybody, that's who you are. Somebody said, well, Pastor, I do this, I do that. I know, because I mean, we all in the same boat. We all got shortcomings. But understand this, we are in Christ Jesus, and that's that. And so God has taken off our raggedy robes and has clothed us in rich robes. In verse 5, he says, and let them put a clean turban on his head. So they put a clean turban on his head, and they put the clothes on him, and the angel of the Lord stood by. The angel of the Lord was present as this transformation took place. The angel of the Lord, it's going to get better than this. The angel of the Lord was there. Now, let me be clear. I'm not telling anybody to live in sin. I'm telling everybody to understand that there's no reason for you not to approach God and to come to God to strengthen you because you are worthy because God has declared you righteous. That's all I'm trying to say. And so if we go to verse 6, the Bible says, then the angel of the Lord admonished Joshua, saying, thus says the Lord. That was an admonishment. Here's what God said to Zechariah to tell the people in regards to this vision. The angel of the Lord admonished Joshua, the high priest. This is what the Lord said. Israel. And I paraphrase this part. The high priest, if you will walk in my way, and if you will keep my command, let me stop there. Israel, instead of you looking at yourself in the mirror and being depressed and despondent and disconnected, here's what you need to do. Joshua, high priest, instead of you looking at yourself in the mirror and feeling like you're raggedy, I want you to understand that that's not the issue. You're not raggedy because your iniquity has been taken from you. But this is what you got to do. We talked about this last night. There are two forms of righteousness. Positional, which we have in Christ. If you're saved, you're positionally righteous. Then there's operational righteousness, that you're walking according to God's will. Verse 6, the angel said unto Joshua, admonished him, chastised him, said, hey, man, let me tell you this right here. You got to know this. If you will walk in my ways and if you will keep my command, that's what God wants us to do, walk in his ways. I want to be clear. To know God's ways and to be able to walk in them and keep his commands, you got to know the word of God. I hate to say this, but I'm going to say it because I'm the pastor and the Lord told me to say it. The biggest challenge that we have faced in the past, and this is what God is changing right now, is that so many people of God, one or two things. We don't know the word of God like we should. And if we do know it, we are nervous in it. Let us be bold in knowing what the word of God says. That means you got to check yourself in the word. That's why it's important for us to know the Word of God, because with the Word of God is in us, sometimes we think the Word of God is just for us to preach a sermon or just for us to try to admonish somebody. The Word of God is for us first. It's for the pastor to check himself. It's for each of us to check ourselves with the Word of God. If we realize we're wrong, we got to come clean to God. But still, at the same time, we have to know the Word of God, and we have to operate in the Word of God. He says it right here. If you walk in my ways, if you would keep my command, God says, you got to walk in my ways. You got to make that a deliberate part of your life to walk in God's ways. Again, it's not about perfection. It's about deciding the walk you want to walk. That's what it's about. I remember when my kids were in high school, the coach would measure, let's say, for example, in the offseason, they had to go to 40 workouts. And if they went to 40 workouts, they would get a letter. They would get whatever they needed. And so I remember laughing because sometimes, I would come back and say, how's the workout? So I didn't do so good today. Or, I've done better or something like that. But I admired that they would both keep going. And so what I began to realize is their efforts, even when they had a bad workout, even when it didn't go the way they wanted to go, they would keep going back because they knew that in doing so would put them in a place for maybe not perfection, but it would elevate them in their athletic, or in particular in this case, football operations. In other words, they developed over time and to the point where I remember very clearly, especially Isaiah senior, the coach came back and said, you know what, he's really grown. Over this time, I remember he was in ninth grade and he was scrawny and couldn't do anything. And now I can see, and it moved on and now he was in a different place. What I'm trying to say is don't give up. Don't quit. Keep on pressing in the Lord. You may not be perfect. None of us would be perfect. But in walking with the Lord, in staying with it, in staying in his word, in staying in prayer, in staying in praise, in staying in worship, what we'll find is God will change us. We may not see the change, but God will change us. I believe I got some folk on this line tonight, whether it's a prayer line or Zoom line, to say that the Lord has changed me, and all we did was subscribe to walking in God's ways and obeying his commands. I got to do a little bit more of them. He says, now, if you do these things, God said, then you will judge my house, have judge in my charge in my court, and I will give you places to walk among those who stand here. Let me say this right here. This is what God is saying. This is very simple. God says, if you keep my ways and walk in my commands. Now, he's talking to the high priest, and the high priest has special privileges, but God is speaking to all of Israel through the high priest, and he's speaking to us now. If you walk in my ways, you keep my commands, you shall judge my house, and likewise have charge of my court. God says, if you walk in my way, and you obey my commands, I will give you access to me. How about that? We'll have access to God. What does that mean? That means when you're praying, even as you're praying, you begin to feel the Spirit of God move on you. You'll feel God's direction. You'll feel his power. You'll feel his presence as we walk in his way. Somebody know what I'm talking about. As we have grown in the Lord, we can feel the Lord. We can hear the voice of the Lord. We can feel the presence of the Lord as we live in our lives because God says, I will give you access. He's not, when he's saying, judge in my house and charge in my court, it's not about authority. It's about access. God is not saying, I'm going to give you authority over nobody. He's saying, I'm giving you access to me. And in having access to God, we know that we have access to peace. We have access to power. We have access to his presence. We have access to provision as we do these things. God said, I want you to have access to me. And that's really congruent with who God has always been. If you go back in the Old Testament, God dwelt among his people. Why? Because he wanted them to have access to him. That's what God wants of us. He wants us to have, come on, say this, access. Let's look at the next thing. God says, I will give you place to walk among those who stand here. I love this part. You know who was standing there when Joshua was talking? The angel. The angel of the Lord was standing there. God says, as you walk with me, I will give you access to me, but I will also give you communion. In other words, God says, I'm not satisfied with you just hanging out with me. I want you to feel my presence. I want you to feel my power, and I want you to be able to commune with me. I want you to be one with me. I want you to be able to know where I want you to go and do what you want me to do without even having to pause because we're so in communion. The angels are always in the presence of God. Y'all know that. The angels are always in the presence of God. Always in the presence of God and God, and they always commune with God. The angels know to rejoice even as God is happy. You know, you've heard this before, that when somebody comes to Christ, the angels in heaven jump. Why? Because they know God is happy. Because they know God is happy, they start to shout and rejoicing with us. The angels have access to God, and they also have communion with God. God is saying, if you walk in my way and you keep my commands, you will have access to me, and you will have communion with me. And I want to tell you somebody this right here. I don't care how much money you got. I don't care how big your house is, what kind of car you drive. I don't care what your title is and how big and bad you are. Ain't nothing better than having access to God. It ain't nothing better than having communion with God. Because if you got access to God, you got communion with God, you have everything you need to take you through this life into the presence of God in eternity. I believe this right here. When we get to heaven, we're going to have access to God, but we're going to be better than the angels, because the angels would never have been through what we've been through. The angels have never been sick. They've never been delivered from sin. They've never experienced down and God got them back up. They've never been knocked out and God pulled them back. They've never been crushed down but not perplexed. They've never had these things happen. So when we get to heaven, we're going to have not only access to God, but we're going to have such a communion. We're going to have, that's why the song said, what a time, what a time, what a time. So I want you to know it's two dimensions, having access to God and communion with God as we walk through this world and walk in his ways, but also having access to God and communion with God into eternity. That's what God wants us to do. He wants us to walk in his ways and walk clean out of this world into his presence in heaven. The Bible says this about Enoch. He walked with God. And he walked with God. He just was with God. God has a plan for us as we walk with him, keep his commands, walk in his ways. We get to feel his full access in this world. We have communion with him in this world, but it pays out in his presence in eternity. I'm going to stop tonight. I pray that this encourages us to continue to walk with the Lord. Don't give up. Don't look at yourself in the mirror and say, I'm not worthy. Look at yourself in the mirror and know that God has taken away your iniquity by the precious blood of Jesus. God has changed our clothes. He has changed us from the ragged person we used to be into new robes that were given to him, given to us by God through Jesus Christ for a new life. And all we got to do is walk in it. Football season started, and I was laughing. Because everybody started pulling out their gear. But most importantly, the football players put on their uniform. But I want to remind you again, whoever played for the Falcons is going to be playing for the Falcons. They're going to act like they're Falcons. They're going to be like they're Falcons. God has called us to do the same thing. You Christians, act like you're a Christian. Walk like you're a Christian.
All right, dude.
So the world
all right,
you a Christian. I'm going to call the time out tonight, but I thank God for you tonight. I thank God for you tonight. And I pray that God would just give us strength and encouragement. I want to pray a special prayer tonight for Mother Finch. That God would touch her body again, and she has been hit with that asthma. But I know we know that God is a healer, so we're already ready.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
God
yes, sir.
Let us close in prayer. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we come tonight, Lord, for the walk that you have called us to walk. We thank you that you love us so much. You want us to walk with you, that you want us to enjoy your presence and commune with you. And we pray, God, that you know that it's not just a command, but it's also something you desire for us so that we will experience what you have for us. Help us to hear your word. In Deuteronomy, help us to hear your word. In each of the scriptures, Colossians and Zechariah and all the other scriptures we study, help us to walk with you. And as we walk with you, God, we already saying thank you for your presence. We thank you, Lord, for the fact that our iniquities are gone. And we thank you, Lord, for the communion we get to have with you as we walk with you. God, help us to picture it. Help us to see it in our spiritual minds and help us to embrace it and live for you. God, I pray that every household is blessed. I pray that every family is blessed. I pray that every individual who's on the phone or on Zoom tonight will be mightily blessed because of what this word, your word tonight. And I pray, God, that you let your word again get in our ears, get in our heart, that we may be strengthened, get in our feet, that we may be established and rooted in you. Let your word get in our mouths so we can declare it. Let it get in our minds so we can think it. And, Lord, let it get in our lips that we may declare not only to the world, but we declare to the world, we declare to each other, we declare to ourselves that you are God and the best thing to do is to walk with you. Even as money comes and goes, help us to want to walk with you. Even as riches come and go, and houses and cars come and go, and fame and fortune and health, all these things come and go, help us, Lord, to walk with you. God, we love you, and we pray a special prayer tonight for all the sick and shut in at St. Peter. And we pray a special prayer for Mother Fancy. You would just touch her. First of all, Lord, lift her spiritually and mentally and emotionally above how her body feels. And then, Lord, we do as you touch her body. And, Lord, let her breathing be free. Let it be so. In Jesus' name, we say thank you, Lord, and amen. God bless you, St. Peter.